My name is Matt York, and I'll be singing some songs here for you for the next hour or so. I think this is my first time in Walpole. I grew up in Foxborough, and then I lived in Westwood, so I know this area very well. But I don't think I've ever performed in Walpole. I learned how to play guitar, though, here at Walpole Music Store when I was a young kid. So it's fun to be back in this area. I live in Pembroke, Massachusetts now on the South Shore, and I'll just give you a kind of quick synopsis of what I'm doing here. I've been a singer-songwriter my whole life. I've been able to perform throughout the country and Canada, playing my own songs. But I've always been really heavily influenced by these men whose songs I'm going to play tonight and so or today. So if you're not familiar with the Highwaymen, they were Johnny Cash, Willie Nelson, Kris Kristofferson, and Waylon Jennings. They were all big stars by the time they joined together and made their first album in 1985. Their careers had intersected in different ways, and the songs that I'm going to play today are not just songs done by the Highwaymen themselves. It's more songs that were songs of their own that they made famous. They made three albums together, one in 1985, one in 1990, and one in 1995. Waylon and Johnny Cash have passed away. Kris Kristofferson is 87 years old, I believe. He actually performed in Boston right before COVID, but he is no longer performing. I was just talking with these folks earlier that I saw Willie Nelson perform in the fall down in Connecticut. He was playing in front of 30,000 people. And his two sons are musicians on each side of him, playing guitar and singing with him. And he just turned 89 last month. He's still going. He's still going. So the first song I'm going to play is a song called Big River. And it was originally a hit song for Johnny Cash in the late 50s. And it was on the first Highwaymen album as well. I always play this one first because it's just one of my favorites of the Highwaymen. And you know, one of the things that I think is that has been true of when I go around and do this is people are most interested in Johnny Cash. I find I had a woman joke with me. She's like, "I'm so glad that you're doing this because I can't get my husband to go and see like an art gallery opening, but I can get him to hear sing Johnny Cash songs." So Johnny's kind of my meal ticket. Atop the weeping willow, how to cry, cry, cry. And I showed the clouds how to cover up a clear blue sky. The tears I cried for that woman, they're gonna flood you, big river. And I'm gonna sit right here until I die. Well, I met her accidentally in St. Paul, Minnesota. And it tore me up every time I heard her drawl, southern drawl. I heard my dream was back down the street, the Morton and Davenport. And I followed you, big river, when you called. Then you took me to St. Louis, later on down the river. A freighter said she's been here, but she's gone, boy, she's gone. I found her trail in Memphis. But she just walked up the block, raised a few eyebrows and went on down alone. Now won't you batter down by Baton Rouge, River Queen, roll it on. Take that woman on down to New Orleans, New Orleans. Go on, I've had enough. Dump my blues down in the gulf. She loves you, big river, more than me. Now I taught the weeping willow how to cry, cry, cry. And I showed the clouds how to cover up a clear blue sky. The tears I cried for that woman, they're gonna flood you, big river. And I'm gonna sit right here until I die. And I'm gonna sit right here until I die. And I'm
gonna sit right here till I die.
Thank you very much. Thank you. So I started doing these Highwaymen performances right before COVID, and over a 3-month period, I have two teenage daughters, so I'm in the thick of it right now. And my wife and I, my wife is also a musician, but we both had corporate jobs, and in a 3-month period of time during the pandemic, I lost my job, she lost her job, and then it was Christmas, and in between that, my dad passed away. So it was a tough stretch there in late 2020. And so I had to figure out like what I was going to do, and I really didn't want to go back to working in an office. And I just really found that during COVID, music was just something that was had become even more important to me. Even though I was doing music in a huge way back then, I wanted to do it even more so. And so I started doing these, and about a year ago, I was doing a performance somewhere, just doing my own music. And a guy came over to me and he said, you know, there are these cultural council grants that different towns give, and I think that what you're doing would be a really good thing for different towns. And so I went home to my wife and I said, you know what, I'm just gonna apply to as many as I can apply for, and see how that goes, and then maybe I won't have to work. And I used to be a newspaper writer, so I was like, I'm gonna write a book about these guys, and I'm gonna, you know, I've got this whole plan. And so, so today is not a cultural council performance. I'm just here because the good folks were nice enough to have me here. But so I applied to almost 300 towns. I spent basically all of the month of October applying for these grants, and around Thanksgiving is when they started returning the. I started receiving replies, and I got 50 straight no's, and I said, I think this is not going to be what I get to do. And then I got a phone call from this guy who was on one of the councils, and he's like, no, he's like, that's the way it's going to work. He's like, you're gonna get your no's first, and then there's kind of this little period of time where people can appeal if they want to, and then you'll start getting yeses. So I have received 120 different grants from across the state. So I'm doing 6 of these in the next 5 days, and I'm doing 25 a month basically from now and through October. And so, thank you. So it beats working, and so I'm literally just crisscrossing the state, and it's a good thing gas isn't expensive right now. So the next song I'm going to do is a song by Kris Kristofferson. I always think of Kris Kristofferson when I was a kid as the guy that my mom thought was really hunky. When I did write a book about the Highwaymen, and it was funny because my mom read it, and she's like, I had no idea Kris Kristofferson could sing. And he made over 90 movies, so he did definitely go full on into the movie world. But in all seriousness, he had a huge, huge impact on songwriting in Nashville. He had an incredible backstory. He was Oxford. He attended Oxford as a Rhodes Scholar. He was a Golden Gloves boxer. He was a great, great athlete. He was a pilot in the military. So he had this pedigree that sounded more like he'd become a U.S. senator, or, you know, he really had all of the different boxes checked, and decided to become a custodian at Columbia Records in Nashville. And so that's what he did. He really wanted to meet Johnny Cash, and he wanted to sing Johnny Cash his songs, and he was confident that if that happened, he would... you know, it would propel him to stardom, and he was right. He was eventually able to get the songs into the hands of June Carter, and she gave them to Johnny. And Sunday Morning Coming Down is the song I'm going to play now. And Johnny Cash was the one that made it famous in 1971. It was the country music song of the year that year. It's the only song that I know of that all four of the Highwaymen individually recorded. You know, it's Bob Dylan and Willie Nelson both have talked about how you can kind of trace the changes in Nashville to Christofferson arriving in the late 60s, early 70s, in that you had kind of simpler lyrics prior to him arriving. And then when he came along, whenever I play this song, Sunday Morning Coming Down, when I'm done with it, I feel like I've read like a movie script. Like, it's so layered in detail, and you feel like you've traveled with this person in a way that was different than the songs that came before that. And it's really funny, especially compared to Willie Nelson used to say that it made him work a lot harder as a songwriter, even though Willie was long an established star songwriter at that point, and has always kind of used sparse lyrics, but uses them in a very powerful way. So this is Sunday Morning Coming Down. Well, I woke up Sunday morning with no way to hold my head that didn't hurt. The beer I had for breakfast wasn't bad, so I had one more for dessert. And I fumbled through my closet, through my clothes, and found my cleanest dirty shirt. Then I washed my face and combed my hair, and stumbled down the stairs to meet the day. I'd smoked my mind the night before with cigarettes and songs that I'd been picking. But I lit my first and watched a small kid playing with the can that he was kicking. And I walked across the street and caught the Sunday smell of someone frying chicken. And it took me back to something that I lost somewhere, somehow along the way. On a Sunday morning sidewalk, I'm wishing, Lord, that I was stoned. Oh, there's something in a Sunday that'll make your body feel alone. Yeah, there's nothing short of dying half as lonesome as the sound of a sleeping city sidewalk. Sunday morning coming down. In the park I saw a daddy with a laughing little girl that he was swinging. And I stopped beside a Sunday school and listened to the songs that they were singing. I headed down the street, and somewhere far away a lonely bell was ringing. And it echoed through the canyon till I disappeared in dreams of yesterday. On a Sunday morning sidewalk, I'm wishing, Lord, that I was gone. Oh, there's nothing that'll make your body feel alone. Yeah, there's nothing short of dying half as lonesome as the sound of a sleeping city sidewalk. Sunday morning coming down. Thank you so much. I do a Willie Nelson song next. Willie is my favorite songwriter of all time, and I was a rock and roll kid, and at some point I found Willie, and I lived in Austin briefly when I was a kid, and when I was down there, it was probably 1982, and it was kind of when Willie was like at the height of his superpowers, like everywhere you went, it was Willie and bandanas, and You know, he's certainly the only person that could lay claim that he wrote songs for Patsy Cline and that he has done duets with Snoop Dogg. You know, he really has run the gamut through the years. He's been a star for 60 years now, you know, and long before the kind of bandana guy that we think of, he had, you know, in during the 60s, he had a whole bunch of hit songs for folks like Patsy Cline and Roger Miller and a number of other artists. I play this song a lot. It's not necessarily a song that a lot of folks know, but I just love it, and I love the story behind it. So Willie wrote a song called Hello Walls for a guy named Farron Young, who was a country star in the 60s. And Willie had, some of you may remember in the 90s, Willie wasn't very good with money. And fortunately, he just made so much of it that I think he overcame the problem. But historically, he wasn't really great with it. And so in the early 60s, Willie wrote a song called Family Bible, and he sold the song for, I believe, $50 to a guitar teacher in Texas. And that song went on to sell 10 million records, and so not a great move. Willie wrote a song called Hello Walls, and he went to Farron Young, and Farron Young was a star at this point. And he said, Farron, I'll sell you this song for $500. And Farron said, I'll tell you what, I'll give you the $500, and then when this song goes to number one, you can pay me back. And he said, that's a deal. And shortly thereafter, the song went to number one for Farron Young, and Willie received a check in the mail for about $20,000 for royalties. And he walked down to Tootsie's Orchid Lounge, which is still there in Lower Broadway in Nashville, and he found Farron Young in there. He walked up to him, he handed him $500, and he gave him a best big kiss on the lips and said it was the greatest kiss he ever had. So, but I love this song, especially in contrast to the Kris Kristofferson song that I just played, because there are so few words to this song. I think it's an incredibly stark and beautiful song, but also kind of humorous. Hello, walls. How things go for you today? Don't you miss her? Since she up and walked away, and I bet you dread to spend another lonely night with me. But lonely walls, I'll keep you company. Hello, window. Well, I see that you're still here. Aren't you lonely? Since our darling disappeared, well, appears that a teardrop in the corner of your pain. Now, don't you try. That it's real. She went away and left us all alone the way she planned. Guess we'll have to learn to get along without her if we can. Hello, ceiling. I'm gonna stay with you a while. You know I can't see. So won't you bear with me a while? We gotta all stick together, or else I lose my mind. I got a feeling she'll be gone a long, long time. Thank you. Thank you very much. I just like to say, folks, I spend a lot of time in senior centers and libraries. You got a good deal here in Walt. This is a good setup. You really do. I've seen quite a few. I really have, and I know a lot about libraries too. If you have any library-related questions, I can probably answer them for you. When I do these, I find that that folks are less familiar with Waylon Jennings than the other three. Members of the Highwaymen, And for me, I think of Waylon Jennings as a kid. He did the theme song to Dukes of Hazzard, and he was the narrator. And that was, you know, I just thought they were the coolest show when I was, you know, 8, 9 years old. And I loved Daisy Duke, and so I didn't really know a lot about Waylon as a younger person. But he had a huge impact on country music. He had 18 number one hit songs. He was about as big a star as you could be in the 70s and 80s. And you know, he also has this really crazy story where, you know, he grew up he was a DJ in Texas as a teenager, and he met Buddy Holly and became the bass player for Buddy Holly and the Crickets, and was supposed to be on the plane when Buddy Holly's plane crashed. He swapped seats with the Big Bopper. One of them was sick, and so one of them took the plane and one of them took the bus instead. And you know, and he talked a number of times about how he, you know, kind of battled survivor's guilt from living through that. And you know, I was doing a performance of this not too long ago in Marshfield, I guess, at the library there. And some of you may remember the movie, The Buddy Holly Story, with Gary Busey. That was a guy comes up to me afterwards and he's like, "Hey, I'm the guy that wrote The Buddy Holly Story." He wrote the book that the movie was turned into. And he's a retired attorney now and lives somewhere on the South Shore. And so we just started chatting, and he had interviewed Waylon a few times up for the 4 books and stuff like that. So it was interesting talking to him a little bit about it. But, you know, Waylon then kind of became your traditional country star. He was a good-looking guy. He had a great, great voice. And by the early 70s, he just had this incredible band playing behind him. And, you know, the traditional Nashville sound of having string arrangements and backup singers doing harmonies and stuff, he just didn't want to do that. He wanted his own band to be able to play. He wanted to be able to play the songs that he wanted to play. And that's what he did. And he had the power to do that because he was a really big star. He put out an album in the early 70s called Honky Tonk Heroes that a lot of people think of as the greatest country album of all time. I am one of the people that think that. The game really changed after that because Willie Nelson saw that and said, "Wait a minute, if I want to do exactly what he's doing." And you know, the Willie that most of us probably think of is, it kind of emerged there in the early 70s as well. And he did the Redheaded Stranger album and started collaborating a lot with Waylon, and they did a number of albums together and songs together. And so he really, really had this big impact on country music. And this is probably one of the most famous songs that him and Willie did together. Cowboys ain't easy to love, and they're harder to fool. They'd rather give you a song than diamonds of gold. Lone Star belt buckles and old faded Levi's, and each night begins a new day. If you don't understand him, and he don't die yet, he'll probably just ride away. Mama, don't let your babies grow up to be cowboys. Don't let them pick guitars and drive them old trucks. Let them be doctors and lawyers and such. Mama, don't let your babies grow up to be cowboys. They'll never stay home, and they're always alone, even with someone who loves. Cowboys like smoky old pool rooms and clear mountain mornings. Little warm puppies, children and girls up the mountain. Them that don't know him won't like them, and them that do sometimes won't know how to take it. Ain't wrong, it's just different. But his pride won't let him do the things to make you think he's right. Mama, don't let your babies grow up to be cowboys. Don't let them pick
guitars and drive them old trucks. Let them be doctors and lawyers and so. Mama, don't let your babies grow up to be cowboys. They'll never stay home, but they're always alone, even with someone they love.
Thank you very much. Thank you. I have a little thing here with statistics that I enjoy. As you probably guessed, I actually have a bachelor's degree in economics, so makes perfect sense. I know. But I love numbers and I love data. So between these guys, they were very busy. They had 13 wives between the four of them. They had 27 kids that they claim, you know. So they were very, very busy. All four married young. Waylon had four marriages and six children. Johnny Cash was kind of the lame one. He only had two wives and five kids. Christofferson had eight kids from three marriages, and Willie had eight from four. So they kept active and. one of the things, I'm going to play a song that everybody will know, I think, by Willie Nelson, On the Road Again. And, I started playing the clubs of Boston when I was 15 years old, and I just turned 50 recently. And so I've, for the most part, really done music my whole life. And, it's been an awesome thing. And the bad nights, the good nights that you have, the great nights that you have, carry you over so that the nights that you're playing to a whole bunch of tables and chairs, and you're like, what am I doing here? Why did I miss my kid's soccer game tonight and, to play to an empty room? The next night you have a great crowd, and it's wonderful. And so during COVID, I was home all the time. And like I said, I have two teenage daughters, so it's not always great being home on the weekend, It's and so my wife was suddenly my audience, when everything was shut down. It was funny because I had read that Willie Nelson said somewhere that On the Road Again was his favorite song. And I think that I found myself playing it just because I was anxious to be out and doing this again and being around friends and being around people that love music. And, it's funny, because I'll come and I'll play a senior center in the afternoon. Tomorrow night I'm opening up for a guy from Nashville who is one of the scariest looking guys you've ever seen, and he's on tour. He's touring all over Europe in a couple of weeks. We'll play in front of 500 or 600 people tomorrow night, and I'll just be doing my own music, and it'll be a completely different crowd of a bunch of people that are, in their 20s and drinking way too much, I'm sure. And then the next day I'll be at like an arts festival. So it's a funny life, But one of the things that about On the Road Again that I really resonated with me is I was up in Toronto a few years ago performing, and I was at this music festival, and I was backstage, and it was a small room. It was probably about the size of this stage, and there was a band there from Mexico City, and they were kids. They were probably 19 years old, and they didn't speak much English, and I don't speak any Spanish, so we really couldn't communicate. There was a band there that was from South Korea, and they were this kind of almost like techno-pop band, a hard-to-explain band, but this kind of alternative pop band. They didn't speak any English or any Spanish, and so we were unable to communicate. And three of us had guitars, and one of them had like a little percussion type thing. And I remember just sitting there it seemed like it lasted a long time, but it was really probably only 20 minutes or so, of us just kind of messing around and making noise. And we had this moment, something happened, I got home that night. I remember going back to my hotel, and I opened up Facebook, and I had friend requests, and one of them was from somebody from South Korea. I no idea what their name is. I have no idea. Every time they post, I laugh because I have no idea what it says, but it just reminds me of that moment. And I also had a friend request from one of the kids from Mexico City. And I was like, they got it too. Like, it was this funny thing. Like, it really was a thing that happened where we were like, yeah, you know, we had this little moment together. And I think that's kind of the beauty of music. And to me, this is kind of what that song reminds me of. On the road again. I just can't wait to get on the road again. The life I love is making music with my friends. I can't wait to get on the road again. On the road again. Going places I ain't never been. Seeing things where I may never see again. I can't wait to get on the road again. On the road again. Like a band of gypsies, we go down the highway. We're the best of friends, insisting that the world keep turning our way. And our way is on the road again. I just can't wait to get on the road again. The life I love is making music with my friends. I can't wait to get on the road again. Just can't wait to get on the road again. The life I love is making music with my friends. I can't wait to get on the road again. I can't wait to get on the road again. I can't wait to get on the road again. Thank you.
Johnny Cash, I just finished Merle Haggard. There's a new biography about Merle Haggard that just came out that I just finished the other day, and it's a terrific book. And Merle Haggard was an inmate at San Quentin when Johnny Cash came and performed, and he saw him and said, "Yeah, when I get out," he was like a 20-year-old kid at that point. He said, "When I get out of here, that's what I'm gonna do." And he did. He actually, I believe Merle had more number one hits than Johnny Cash. And he was this, you know, Cash was an incredibly complicated guy. There's no question about it. You know, when people, you know, for those of you that may have seen the Walk the Line movie, the idea that kind of June Carter came along and rescued him and then everything was all better. It wasn't really that simple. He was in and out of rehab a number of times later in life for pill addiction and really struggled his whole life with sobriety. But he also worked very, very hard to keep people sober that that looked up to him. I think there was such a spiritual component to him that I'm not sure that I can articulate, but that is unquestionably there. And I know I'm not a churchgoer myself, but I jog and I've listened to Johnny Cash's gospel albums. Like, I'll go run by the ocean and listen to that music, and something happens to me when I hear it, you know. And he used to joke that people would come up to him and say, "My father was in prison with you," and it didn't seem like that big of a stretch, right? You know, I mean, he'd actually really just spent a handful of nights in jail for various, you know, dumb things that he had done. But he, you know, performed at a number of prisons through the years. He was a big, big advocate of prisoner rights. He met with President Nixon in the early 70s and about prison reform. And, I think that, You know, the fact that he was willing to go there, he believed that people should be punished for their crime. He didn't believe that people should be overly punished for their crimes, and that, you know, that equality was important. And oftentimes he would stand up for things that I think were contrarian to some of his fans in earlier in his career, and just didn't care. He wasn't in Folsom Prison when he wrote Folsom Prison Blues. He was in Germany, and he was stationed in the military at that point. And he had seen the movie Behind the Walls of Folsom Prison, and just thought that would be a good thing to write a song about. And someone asked him, they said, you know, what's the deal with that line, I shot a man in Reno just to watch him die? And he said, you know, he just loved the idea, like, there isn't a more evil reason to do that, to kill somebody, right, than to just watch them die. And so this is Folsom Prison.
I hear the train a-coming. It's rolling round the bend. I ain't seen the sunshine since I don't know when. Well, I'm stuck in Folsom Prison. Time keeps dragging on, but that train keeps on rolling on down to San Antonio. When I was just a baby, my mama told me, son, always be a good boy, don't ever play with guns. But I shot a man just to watch die. When I hear that whistle blowing, I hang my head and cry. There's rich folks from a fancy dining car, probably drinking coffee or smoking big cigars. Well, I know I had it coming. I know I can't be free. Yeah, but those people keep on moving in that wooden consciousness. Well, if they free me from this prison, if that railroad train was mine, I bet I'm moving on a little farther down the line, far from Folsom Prison. That's where I want to stay. Oh, and I let that lonesome whistle blow my blues away.
Thank you. I'm going to play another Kris Kristofferson song and just want to mention a couple things. There's a lot of people don't like Kris Kristofferson's voice, and it never bothered me, but I think he had a pretty limited voice. And Willie Nelson apparently used to give him a hard time all the time about his voice. And in Maui, they had a house in Maui. They had Willie on one property and Chris next door to him, and Woody Harrelson. The three of them were neighbors, and can't imagine how that went. But there's an incredible album if you're ever looking. If you love this type of music, and you might not have heard this album, there's an album called Willie Sings Kristofferson that came out in early '80s. But you can find it on YouTube, and it's out on the Spotify and places like that. And it's just a perfect album. Willie just takes these incredible songs. It might be my favorite Willie Nelson album because he had such a respect for Chris's songs. And it was really at that time when Willie was making just incredible music. And it sounds like all of those albums, those early late 70s, early 80s albums that really, you know, kind of put Willie into a different stratosphere. You know, Chris's most famous song is Me and Bobby McGee. He had dated Janis Joplin briefly before she passed away. He had originally written that song for Roger Miller, who had a hit song with it on the country charts. He had never heard Janice's version of Me and Bobby McGee until after she had passed away. And he heard it, I believe, the day after she passed away. He went into the studio and heard it. And obviously, you know, that would go on to be one of the biggest hit songs of any genre. The song I'm going to play is Help Me Make It Through the Night by Chris. He had a hit song with Rita Coolidge with this song in the mid-70s. Take the ribbon from your hair, shake it loose and let it fall. Lay it soft upon my skin, like the shadows on the wall. Come and lay down by my side to the early morning light. All I'm taking is your time. Help me make it through the night. Yesterday is dead and gone. Tomorrow's out of sight. And it's sad to be alone. Help me make it through the night. I don't care who's right or wrong. Well, I won't try to stand. Let the devil take tomorrow. Tonight I need a friend. Yesterday is dead and gone. Tomorrow's out of sight, and it's sad to be alone. Help me make it through the night. I don't want to be alone. Help me make it through the night.
Thank you very much. Like I said earlier, you know, Willie, you know, Willie had a number of hit songs before he really became a star in his own right as a performer. And it's really funny. If you can go on YouTube and you can find these, like, these videos of Willie playing in like 1965, and he's like wearing a suit, and his hair is all like looking good, and he has no beard, and I'm like, that's not Willie Nelson, but technically it is. He wrote "Crazy" for Patsy Cline, and somehow they say that it's the most played song in the history of jukeboxes, and I always wondering like how'd that get calculated, you know. So I'm a little dubious of that, but I don't know. It's got to be right up there if it isn't. And Willie used to say that 99% of the world's lovers are not with their first choice, and that's what makes the jukebox play. And he wrote "Crazy" for he didn't write it for her, but he wrote it, and he played it to some friends late one night in Nashville. And one of the people that was there was Patsy Cline's husband. And he heard it, and he said, "You got to come to my house." And he went, and he woke up Patsy in the middle of the night, and said, "You got to hear this song." And she recorded it, and the rest is history. A wise man once told me, they're like, don't ever sing songs. If you're covering songs by other artists, don't ever sing songs by people that have a better voice than you. So there's nothing like doing Chris. You know, I could have gone either with Janis Joplin, the last song, or I could have done, you know, Patsy Cline here, and so. Crazy. I'm crazy for feeling so lonely. Crazy. Crazy for feeling so blue.
I knew you'd love me as long as you wanted. And then someday you'd leave me for somebody new. Worry, why do I let myself worry? Wondering what in the world did I do? Crazy for thinking that my love could hold me. Crazy for crying. Crazy for trying. But I'm crazy. Crazy for crying, crazy for trying, I'm crazy for love.
Thank you very much. Thank you. I'm going to play a song that was written by a guy by the name of Billy Joe Shaver. And Billy Joe Shaver, I think if there was a fifth member of the Highwaymen, he probably would have been that guy. He was not nearly as famous as these other four guys, but Billy Joe Shaver wrote perfect songs, in my opinion. That's what he did. And he was, Johnny Cash called him his favorite songwriter of all time. Willie called him his all-time favorite songwriter from Texas. Chris Christopherson produced Billy Joe Shaver's first album, and the Honky Tonk Heroes album that I mentioned earlier that Waylon Jennings recorded, all but one of those songs was written by Billy Joe. And Billy Joe is this big, giant cowboy of a guy who's about 6'3". He passed away during COVID, and good-looking, just a mountain of a guy. And he got his hand stuck in one of those machines that... Yeah, and he lost 3.5 of his fingers when he was a young guy. So he could kind of play guitar, kind of. And he was just, you know, if all of these guys were known as outlaws, he was the craziest of them for sure. And he had a really unique way. They called him the Hillbilly Shakespeare. And and you would listen to him talk, and you'd never let him do your taxes. I mean, he definitely did not... seemed like the brightest bulb on the tree, but he just had this way with words that was really remarkable. And in a 1 year period, in when he was in his maybe in the 1990s, I guess, he had a guitar player who was his son, Eddie Shaver, who was just this virtuoso type, almost like a Stevie Ray Vaughan type, and they toured all over the place together. In a 1 year period, he was his only child. He lost his son, Eddie, to an overdose. He lost his wife, and he lost his mother all in the same year. And then he had a heart attack shortly thereafter, and, you know, was, but somehow kind of worked his way back. And then when Billy Joe was, I got these little notes. I always find this story funny. Billy Joe was, probably in his early 60s, and he married a woman that was much, much, much younger than him, much, much, much younger than him, like 30. And they were at a bar in Texas, and one afternoon, just having some drinks, and a guy came over and started giving him a hard time about the age discrepancy between his wife and him. And they started to argue, and Billy Joe took out a little pistol, and he shot the guy in the face. And even in Texas, you can't do that, you know. They don't even allow that there, you know. So he was arrested, and everyone was like, wait, but Billy Joe's like the nicest guy. Like, Billy Joe wouldn't shoot a guy in the face unless the guy deserved it, right? And so Willie Nelson got him the very best attorneys that money could buy, and he went to trial. If some of you may remember the movie Crazy Heart with Jeff Bridges that came out about 15 years ago that Robert Duvall directed. And Robert Duvall, it's funny, Billy Joe had three best friends, Willie Nelson, Robert Duvall, and the comedian Norm Macdonald.
And so the trial, went to trial, and Billy Joe sat there, and Willie Nelson and Robert Duvall sat there in the Texas courtroom right behind him in the front row. And they asked Billy Joe, he testified in his trial, and the prosecutor asked him if he was scared because the guy that had approached him was much younger. And he said, "Ma'am, I'm from Texas. I'm not afraid of anything." And they said, "Well, maybe you were jealous about the fact that that this man was talking to your wife and she was much younger than you." And Billy Joe's quote, I love this quote, "I get more women than a passenger train can haul. I'm not jealous of anything." Billy Joe was found not guilty of shooting a guy in the face. She probably would have guessed, right? And on he went. He literally got out of jail, and then he made an album called It's Hard to Be an Outlaw When You're Not Wanted. And Willie and him made music together, and off he went. And this song is called I'm Gonna Live Forever. It was on the second Highwaymen album. It's a beautiful, beautiful song. I sang the song actually at my father-in-law's funeral, and I've been asked to perform at a few different opioid vigils, and I performed it at this. I think it's such a beautiful song, and Billy Joe, just like I said, he just has such a beautiful way with words. I'm gonna live forever. I'm gonna cross that river. I'm gonna catch tomorrow now. You're gonna wanna hold me just like I always told you. You're gonna miss me when I'm gone. Nobody here will ever find me, but I will always be around. Just like the songs I leave behind, I'm gonna live forever. You fathers and you mothers, be good to one another. Please try to raise your children right. Don't let the darkness take them. Don't make them feel forsaken. Just lead them safely to the light. When this old world is blown asunder and all the stars fall from the sky, remember someone really loves you. We'll live forever, you and I. I'm gonna live forever. I'm gonna cross that river. I'm gonna catch tomorrow now. I'm gonna live forever. I'm gonna cross that river. I'm gonna catch tomorrow. Billy Joe Shaver. Thank you very much. I'm going to do a couple more songs for you. I want to thank you all for coming. It's like summer out. It's crazy. I know. It was going to happen eventually. Today's that day. So I really appreciate it. This is a great, great crowd. It truly is a funny thing doing what I do, because you just never know what is going to be there when you arrive. And more oftentimes it's good than bad, but it isn't always good. the next song I'm going to do is a song that Willie and Waylon Jennings made famous called Good Hearted Woman. And I love this song so much because these guys made a whole bunch of music together. And one of the funny things with the Highwaymen is that Willie and Waylon had worked together. Willie and Chris had worked together. They all had kind of intersected with each other's careers through the years, Johnny Cash and Willie really didn't have much of a relationship with each other, and so they tried to make an album that was going to just be like a duets type album, and it just didn't work. Willie's voice, he kind of sings behind the beat. He's just kind of got his own quirky little style, and Johnny has his own style, obviously, and they just couldn't make it work. And then at some point, the idea was to have the four of them to join forces and make these albums together. But this song was done by Willie and Waylon around 1975, I guess. And I think it's my favorite song that the two of them did together.
a long time forgotten. The dreams are just filled that away. The good life you promised ain't what she's living today. But she never complains of the bad times or the bad things he's done. She just talks about the good times they've had and all the good times to come. She's a good-hearted woman in love with a good-timing man. She loves his ways, but she don't understand. With teardrops and laughter, they'll pass through this world and the next. Good-hearted woman, loving a good time. He likes the bright lights, the night light, and his good time and friends. And when the party's all over, she'll welcome him back home. Lord knows she don't understand him. She's doing the best that she can. Good-hearted woman, loving a good time. She's a good-hearted woman, love with a good time. She loves me in spite of my wicked ways. She don't understand. With teardrops and laughter, they'll walk through this world. Good-hearted woman, loving a good time, man. Good-hearted woman, loving a good time, man.
Thank you so much. You know the summer's coming here when my guitar's slipping out of tune. Guitars and humidity. Acoustic guitars especially. So I'm going to do one more song for you. Just a couple things I'd mention. First off, I want to, again, thanks to the Senior Center for having me out here, because I appreciate it. I don't have much stuff today. Usually I have stuff. I sold out all my CDs. They're supposed to be arriving today. I wrote a book over the winter about these guys, and I'll just talk about it for 2 seconds, and if you're interested in it, you can certainly come and grab one afterwards. So like I said, I was a newspaper writer for a while, and so what I tried to do with this book is write a little bit about each one of these guys, so that if you're, you know, not a deep dive into their lives or anything, but just, you know, some of my favorite stories that I've heard about them or read about them and things like that. And the other thing that I do is I try to kind of be this human algorithm. So every time that I do a performance like this, I have somebody come up to me and they say, I hate modern country music. And I hate modern country music too. I can't stand it. I couldn't name you any songs by any of those artists. Whatever you like, great. I'm happy that people like it. I just don't know what, it's not what I'd listen to. But there are tons and tons of wonderful, wonderful country artists out there that are not household names. So like the guy that I'm playing with tomorrow night, down in Texas, he probably plays to 1,500 people on a regular night. He's a star down in the South. You know, and he's not someone that you necessarily have, I'm sure you've never heard of him, but what I tried to do in the book is try to connect the dots of you know, here's some folks that you may not have known about. If you really love this type of music, you might not have known about these guys in the 70s that were lesser stars, but that were kind of similar, like Billy Joe Shaver that I was just talking about. But also talk about some of the newer artists that have been so heavily influenced by these guys, and just how the music landscape has changed so dramatically, where, you know, people don't, younger people especially, don't buy CDs anymore. You know, there's no, so as a band, before you'd go out on the road and you'd sell a bunch of CDs and that would get you to the next stop. And now with Spotify and YouTube and things like that, there's no revenue for musicians, for independent musicians in particular. And so that's had this real, you know, shift as well for folks. But so that's basically what it's about. And the last thing I'd mention about it is that Willie Nelson, you know, I mentioned him earlier about how he has played in front of 30,000 people. One of the awesome things that Willie does is he finds these bands that are or acts that are similar in style to what he loves, and he brings them out on the road. So a band that might otherwise play in front of 500 people in Boston are playing in front of 30,000 people, you know, who almost all of whom have never heard of them, but you know, they get an opportunity to play in front of a huge crowd like that. So I think it's a really cool thing that Willie does. And and he just had a birthday party for himself about a couple weeks ago down in Texas. Willie owns his own town. He owns a town called Luck, Texas. They made a movie years ago, and he just said, you know what, just leave everything here. I'm going to buy it all. And so it's got like a saloon. It's got a little church. And he's got a golf course. I mean, I'm hoping to come back as Willie. That's and usually I have business cards and CDs, and I'm out of both. But if you are interested in coming to see me again, mattyorkmusic.com is my website. I have a mailing list here that if you want to sign up for, you can. Like I said, I'm basically coming to 100 and something towns in the next. So if I'm not coming again to Walpole this year, I'm definitely coming to Norwood or Foxborough or wherever, because trust me, I'm everywhere. I have no idea when or where I'm coming to any of those places. But once a month, I send out an email, and I tell people where I'll be. I think people like them because I usually include some good videos of these guys, kind of like random videos for people to watch. And so it's mattyorkmusic.com if you're interested. And this is the final song, and it is I Walk the Line by Mr. Johnny Cash. Thank you very much for listening. Thank you so much, and Have a great day and enjoy the summertime.